So. Hello, Alain. I was wanting to say that the whole time. That's right. My name is Marc. I'm a graphic designer. Sorry, my voice is really gone. I'm going through a very severe cold for the last couple of days. So if you hear this like sexy vibes, just enjoy it, right? I'm a senior designer of Bleed. I will talk about Bleed in a minute. Just want to say thank you for having me. I'm really happy to be here. Thank you to Victoria, Till, and all the people like initiating this nice festival. And also to Zoran, like who had like talked like two talks before. Really like not like a hero of my youth, but how can I say, like really. Yeah, basically the kickoff to my puberty when I was like around 14 and saw like Mein Teil from Rammstein in my little like baby bedroom. It was just remarkable. I made up this talk like in three sections. Like the first section is like I will introduce myself and Bleed. The second one I will somehow compromise a few thoughts I had on creating memories against dystopia. And the third one is I will basically elaborate on three case studies we did with Bleed. So first of all, is all fine? Oh. Do you see me now? All right. Shortly about Bleed. Bleed was founded in Oslo in 2000. And we have also an office in Vienna. I work in the office in Vienna. It was founded in 2000. By two founders in Oslo, and our office in Vienna like exists for around 7.5 to 8 years. We are in total around 20 people, so 15 in Oslo and 5 to 6, 7 in Vienna. We are slightly growing, which we really enjoy. Like it's really getting bigger and bigger, and we basically work in the field of visual identity, service design, experience design. So this is basically the whole conglomerate of work that we do. I brought a little showreel for you, just for you to get like a little insight on the work we do. Yeah, for you to get a better understanding. Great, can we get the sound even louder maybe? I mean, we're in a cinema, so just pump it up. The question, like what I was asking myself is like, what is the future that I would like us to live in and I would like to design in? Like, I kind of like was questioning myself and took the initial idea, like the subtopic, like creating against dystopia as some kind of like, how can I say, like a reference point on reflect on work or how I would like work to be. And of course, like we are all like living now in the ages where like, you know, machine learning, augmented reality, AI and so on. And I was asking myself like, what is actually a dystopia I don't want to like work in. And it's less like the loss of data in a way, like data in a measurable kind of like unit, but more in data as some kind of like experience, or you know, having like a personal relationship to your data, like I would call it an emotional kind of affection, or like a memory. Let's talk it as simple as that. And I think like the loss of memory is actually that what makes us, or basically the gathering, the generation of memory is that what makes us very human. It makes us like tangible, it makes us like exchange knowledge and exchange skills. And this is like what we as communication designers, like I would consider myself a graphic designer or a communication designer, is basically what we're aiming to do, like making content functional and making content like aesthetically pleasing and aesthetically kind of like transferring from like one transmitter to the other one, if you can follow me. And I thought like it would be interesting kind of like think further than that, think of just like a functional kind of level, but more like in a more experience kind of level. And I was just trying to think more in a context kind of way. And I actually would like to live in a world where an emotion or a kind of like an experience I have is more than just like a hashtag, and is more than something you can drag through a filter. It's something that you, how can you say, you can like generate and really share and really can like occupy and really rework and transform and communicate. And this is how this topic like creating memories came in my mind, because like basically what we're all aiming for is not only creating like experiences through any work we do, like is it graphic work, is it architecture, is it media work, whatever, but actually we would like to make it last. So we would like to create a memory. We would like to have, our ideal would be somebody comes to us like in, I don't know, 10, 20 years, whatever, and talk to us, hey, I remember that thing you did. That's something that's more lasting than just like an immediate event. But we are like in an event-based society right now. We are sharing experience and they are more immediate. We're sharing them on social media. And things like TikTok, they are like gone in a second, so they're not even lasting. So we're not even like work on lasting moments. And yeah, I basically came up with this idea of like creating memories, and I came across like an artwork that I don't know if you know the artist, Trevor Paglen. Does anybody know him? Know his work? No? Trevor Paglen is an American artist who's working with machine learning. And like this work is called Behold These Glorious Times. It's from 2017. And basically in this work, Trevor Paglen is unveiling how machines learn. Like the way how an AI learns, there are several kind of like training sets, you know? There are a training set where the AI learns, this is how a human body looks like, this is how a cat looks like, this is how war looks like, you know? Just, and in any of these training sets, there are like thousands of images incorporated. And this is what Trevor Paglen kind of like demonstrates in his work. It's a video installation. And the AI basically learns through this software and basically dissects any image in like grids and learns how this image is basically like set up. And through this, like the AI learns how basically the world, like the things we are kind of like controlling over social media and over like the internet is basically working, the visual content. And the thing is, like this AI makes a lot of mistakes. That's the remark of this artwork. For instance, like in the training set, doctors are always male, while nurses are always female. And it even goes that far that like African-American people, the AI is basically confusing them with gorillas. So this goes like way beyond like, and this is like realities that we are living in. This is like this harsh kind of like way how we produce visual data that the AI basically learns from, that the AI generates like new kind of meaning. This is how we like rework, that we re-communicate data. And yeah, this is basically like things that any one of us is like, how can I say, like, is confronted with. Because when you, like, for instance, like, liking an image of a mother with a baby on social media, then on, like, four websites further, you get, like, I don't know, commercial for diapers, or you get baby articles or whatever. So this is how the machine learns from your behavior, from the way you produce kind of like media remembrance, or media memory, I would call it, and then basically distracts this kind of like information and really confronts you with it. And that's kind of like monetization of data. This is how basically big companies and big concerns is basically like infiltrating your behavior on the website and basically really generating this data and making it to money. And I mean, this is like, just in a reality that we really are confronted with, and something that just makes me further. And like, it reminds me of like a work we did with Bleed in a way, which is the Bleed body. I call it here. Wait, let me take a sip, because my voice lost me, starting losing me already. The Bleed body is an interactive installation we did in 2016 on the invitation of the Vienna Design Week. It's a design festival that takes place in Vienna. And here, we got an invitation to this kind of like spot where basically like they invite graphic designers to do something with it. It's like a room in the Vienna Design Week headquarters most of the time, and you can do something. Like most studios, like they sit in with the computers and work in. And we said no, we want to do like something participatory with the people, with the visitors of the Vienna Design Week. So we made an interactive installation. And it was a big like wall projection, and it works through data we kind of collected from the participants. And we took like a theorem from Spinoza, it's a philosopher, and he says like if you have many different bodies, it can create one big body. And if one of these bodies in the big body is kind of like goes somewhere, it can actually like influence and manipulate and kind of like influence the other bodies in this bigger body. So there's like a relationship between many different bodies, like maybe we are here in this room, that becomes like one big body, the cinema. Yeah. So it was like an interesting like thought to just go through, and we made like an interface which consists of three kind of like parameters. It's gender, age, and mood, and people could actually like divide with a slider, like how female or male they could feel, how old or young, and like what's their mood on this very special day. Yeah, so that was not like a yes or no, or like a black and white. So that was like a sliding thing, and every of these kind of like parameters had an effect on this bigger structure that we project on the wall. And for instance, it depended like how like the rounder the one of the dots were, like the more female you feel, the more like, you know, corny and edgier, the more male, the happier the person was, the livelier and more like fluctuating the dot was, and the more like, you know, like sadder, the more like, you know, slower. And if you like feel in a good mood, or if you feel more distant, then the dot becomes more distant. And if you feel more close, the dot becomes more close. So this kind of was like a momentary situation. It showed like a Stimmungsbild, so called, from the way how the visitors basically participated the Vienna Design Week. And there was like several different configurations, and it was very interesting to see how the body kind of like was fluctuating and changing and altering. And also like depending on the way how many like, you know, dots were like outside of the thing, that the color changed of the whole body. So like one single dot could have an influence on the whole system. So there was a pretty interesting kind of like a research module. So there were several different states. We kind of like printed it in a nice little booklet. We handed it in to the hosts. And yeah, it was a nice project. And the whole project lays basically for us to prepare and to execute was 1 week. We had no idea what to do for this invitation. So yeah, we just decided to do that, which was fine, I think. also brought like a little showreel for us to show you. It's just, of course, you know, kids loved it. They played around with it. Yeah, it was super nice and inspiring. And yeah, just give you a little showreel how they get a feeling. Back to this initial topic that I had, creating memories. When you think, like, I think most of you are design, like, students from FH Salzburg, I guess, right? So, people nodding already. If you think of, like, one special moment when that you, like, basically that happened to you in your life, like, that you saw, like a Schlüssel moment, a key moment, that made you actually, like, choose, for instance, the study you took. Is there like some moment that comes into your life? If yes, just like raise your hand. Yeah, sweet. Was that moment, was it a digital moment? No. Not at all, perfect. Now, the thing is, like, if you ask this question like in a couple of years, I guess people will ask way differently. This is the way how image production and like memory production, as I call it, is infiltrating us through the use of media and the internet. So there will be like less and less people remembering of, for instance, an exhibition or like a book or a special CD cover or whatever, like a VGS cover, whatever. So it's just a way how work, participate, becomes more and more digital. This is why I also like took the example from Trevor Pacton before, you know, digitalization and the way we percept and we use visual information and we kind of like rework it and recommunicate it. And I was basically just remembering one thing, and this is just like an inner monologue now a bit, so you have to go through this with me now. I was thinking through this, through this aspect, and there was like one moment, when it was in 2001, when my dad gave me a book. It was like squarish, red, linen bound. It had silk screen cover, and he just gave it to me and said, "Yeah, see what you can make from it. I don't need it." My father was is a music fan. Like, he likes rock music, and he read about this in a music magazine. It was a CD. It was a special edition of Amnesiac by Radiohead. Okay, there are some people nodding, yeah. I mean, I was like 12 years old. I had no idea about Radiohead. I learned or listened to the music that I heard on the radio. I had like 10 CDs that looked all different, like this special CD. They felt different, they opened different, so... okay, I was just, yeah, whatever. I put it in a CD player and my little, like, shitty, you know, disc man. Okay, they're not just disc. No, there are not so many people nogging right now. It's as legal, you know, a shitty, like, CD player. And I was sitting in my baby bedroom and listening to this music. And there was, like, this first song packed like sardines in a crushed tin box. And I was drawn in a world, and there were all these cryptic titles: The Pyramid Song, Knives Out, Morning Bell, Life in a Glass House. These are all like these weird cryptic titles that I had like no understanding it when I was 12 years old. And there was this Tom York's like voice, you know, this you had no like I had no idea how it looked like. It was not like as in Zoran's video where I had an idea and I saw these naked Rammstein dudes in the video during my puberty phase, which had an effect on me. But like it was nothing. It was just out of this world. But the thing that was really the most remarkable thing on me was this like CD cover, because it was not like it was so unlike the other 10 CD covers I had. I just opened it, and you could put the CD like in a kind of like slip case in the front, and there were some like loose cards with some kind of like stamps, like in a library. And the whole booklet was just like scrap paper of like, you know, ink drawings and drawings of crying animals and weird text fragments. So that was abstract art for me, right? So I had no like idea this, and like together with this music, this became so permanent, so present. Like it was me, it was in this room, there was this music, there was this cover, there were these weird visuals I was playing. So I really can remember it. I can remember it like, I don't know, 9/11 where I've been. It was so permanent. And like I had no idea like what I wanted to do. I had no idea. I know I was this weirdo kid, I was drawing. Yeah, just later on, it became like more present. I want to become like an illustrator, you know, because you read, okay, you want to draw, okay, you want to make it to money, you become an illustrator, right? So that was just like such an imminent kind of like effect. And the thing that I was asking myself, and this is like more or less kind of a conclusion for the second part that I was predicting about, before I come to three case studies that I want to show you from work that we do. It was just like this context of a work, you know, like you have really the surrounding, you have the all these like kind of like feelings you have with it. And I was wondering, why is it not always the case what we're doing or what I'm doing? Why don't I have like more kind of like approach or like capability or kind of like control over the context of the stuff that I'm doing? Why can I not like, influence the way a person looks at a book that I'm doing for the first time, the surrounding, yeah? Why do I always like, we are concentrating on the medium and we have all these grids and you have all the content and you throw it in the content and the layout and then it becomes, you put it to the printer, it's off your control, then you get the finished book and that's it. It's like a pizza you get out of the oven, right? For instance, just from a book side, whatever you do, websites, whatever you're doing, apps or all the loony animation, weird game things you're doing over there, which is amazing. So why don't you have like more control about the surrounding that you're doing? And that was really some question that's like kind of like constantly influencing me and constantly, driving me. And I tried to strive for more control. And just later on in my studies, I was studying graphic design at the University of Applied Arts in Vienna. With like one stop in Berlin, one semester there, and it was like, okay, what do I want to do? Like, which direction do I want to go? And I was always like working a lot. This is why my studies took way longer than I hoped it would be. And like one initial like how can I say like moment was when I got an internship at Studio Damm in Rotterdam, which was just amazing. Like it was just great to be there. It's a great studio. I don't know how many people of you know the studio. It's a big kind of like studio for branding and visual identity, and they have like this Dutch approach. You know, they have like this really a special approach, like, you know, the Swiss design style, if you're like familiar with graphic design work, and you have the Dutch approach, which is very bold, very confident, very forward-driven, very formalist also. But it's something that really intrigued me, and it really dragged me into this world of visual identity, which was very, very, which was a way for me to, how can I say, to actually be more in control of the context of the work, you know? I think that's also the field that I'm mostly working in right now, really controlling more the context of the work. And this is where I'm sticking today. And actually like the one of the initial moments was also like working with clients. I see myself like as a designer with a commercial practice of design, like I left, you know, the experimentation of the art school behind and tried to really like make money out of the work I'm doing. And really this moment where this kind of like experience, you know, creating experience became memories kind of thing, which was very present, like in the last time as I saw you. It became very present also in the work that I did for my diploma, which is a book which I have here. where basically I set this moment of like people generating memories, one step further. And here, like in this book, it's a very small volume. And in this book, basically, I wanted designers to communicate with one of their clients about the work they do. I want them both to remember back in the process and really remember back in the way how they did work together. So all the book is about, it's about dialogues. And I was studying at Angewandte. And Angewandte, you know, has a long tradition in people that studied there, for instance, Stefan Sagmeister and so on. And I was basically gathering 10 positions out of these people, 10 studios or single designers, together in a conversation with one of their designers. And it was just very inspiring to really like engage them in a work they did together, to really see like what were their like attitude on both like sides, what was the designer expecting from a client and a client from a designer, because you know there is like we all know we have pretty big egos in a way, and also like clients have like you know like a thing that they want and a thing that they really would like to progress in, you know. And basically we are designers because we are not kind of like, you know, expressing ourselves like an artist probably, although we use artistic methods, but we speak, or basically the client speaks through our filter. Like the communication, the message, at least for me as a graphic designer, it was always more interesting like having the problems of others than having my own problems. This is why I decided to become a graphic designer, not an artist. This is the book. Just a few spreads out of it. With Stefan Sagmeister, I made a dialogue just one, like one by one. So he basically talked about his process, about what was good about his clients, what was bad, like what was the process, and the whole thing like became very, very self-driven. And there were a lot of like interesting positions I had here. For instance, Tino Erben was the leader of the University of Applied Arts graphic design class two decades before like the current professor. Like he was the professor before von Sigmann was professor there. And he, for instance, like was the one who basically initiated people there to work on computers. Like before they had, you know, like letra set and sticking paper and like color charts on drawings and sending them to the print and hope you get a good output. Like first you really had like, he really had the ability to work on hands-on material, like on a digital platform. And so this whole like project was very inspiring. This is Tino Erben, by the way, in his atelier. Is an awesome persona. Like I talked hours with him about the work he did in the past. Like he did great work for Albertina and Le Corbusier and like really, really big, big kind of like people. And he's like still very unknown because he's like so, you know, so shy and so like, you know, not very that outgoing in a way. So I just, it's nice for me to spread his name to you as a younger audience. So just if you want to find out his work, it's just great for you to look at. Just a few more spreads. There were even like a few theory excerpts from Eric Spiekermann and Christian Reda, which is a cultural scientist from Vienna, who I was very fortunate to get an essay from for the book. So it was very nice, and it was nice that the Angewandte was sponsoring it, which is great, because I actually initially took people from the Angewandte, from the graphic design class, former alumni for the project, so that was also interesting for them. And I think the book became a success, and I think, it was just a very important step during this whole phase, but it's already like almost 8 years ago. I now close the second part, and I would like to go to three project cases that we do. Let me take a sip from the water quickly. The first one is an identity we did for Kunst Uni Linz. It's just a very recent project. Where we also were fortunate to work with Denise Hödel, who's here. Yeah, she's waving. She was an intern during that time. Yeah, she was an intern in our studio. And yeah, just go through the process. Kunst Linz, I don't know who's familiar with it. It's one of the oldest art universities in Vienna. They're sitting the main headquarters of the university sits in these two big former Nazi Gestapo buildings during the Danube. So they already have a history, a burden to really take. And basically, what they're doing inside them is really like the complete opposite. They're really, you know, breaking out, really kind of like twisting the whole context with really great work. It's very like intermediate. There's like a lot of like, you know, urban intervention, a lot of like actionism, a lot of like robotics in a way. So I guess very similar to FH Salzburg. Yeah, there are also very great workshops. You have all these robotics and augmented reality and AI things going on. And like they have three pillars that were very important for them. The one, as I said, like it's this intermediality, the spatial strategy, and the artistic research. So they kind of like had this theory background, they had this spatial strategy, as I said, like with urban intervention and so on, and this intermediality. They were very cross-linked. They were like a big open canvas where people are often like cooperating with each other. So we took this is basically just a quick glimpse of a process of mine. This is just a very small thing, so I always like to use whatever hand and stuff. So, you know, like we're always infiltrating and just digging into the whole thing, just try to how could we like handle this thing and like this massive kind of conglomerate. And actually the interesting thing is what they really wanted to be was this open space for the arts. So we took three concepts, you know? Sometimes one concept alone is not enough. Sometimes it needs three, fair enough. So the room for the arts is one thing, just having like this stream kind of like, you know, like this by the river, so that's a flow of motion as the second principle. And the third one is basically the mirroring. Like it's already mirroring in the water, as you said, but it's also like this mirroring, you know, like art is mirroring society, is mirroring politics, whatever. It kind of like reacts to a certain kind of like, how can I say, certain kind of circumstances. So this is the logo, which we were happy that it got awarded by the European Design Award just recently. And you know, we had this mirroring kind of aspect, so we were initially kind of like twisting the two lens, so it also becomes this kind of like, you know, space thing, if somebody of you noticed it. It should be like dual readable, so you can use it in either way. And yeah, it should be like, also like in bilingual. So the university really wanted to push themselves out and really wanted to become more internationally acknowledged. So just to give you like a few impressions of it, this is the icon, which is the abbreviation on social media. So you have this kind of like spatial aspect. But the main thing of the logo, actually, you have like the thing is the older logo and the new logo, is this kind of opening aspect. Like we really wanted the logo to become like a vessel of the content. We didn't want the identity to become like, how can I say, you know, the main star, but basically the main star is the art and everything that's inside it, right? So here you see just a short principle of the layout, how we initiate it. It's kind of this opening layout where basically everything can be, and everything is possible. So there are like certain stages of the layout. No, it's not cut off, no, shortly not. Yeah, the school and the students have like different kind of like ratios in which they could really fit in their content. We had like a pretty elaborate color system, so we didn't want just to use like black and white, which you might consider for an artistic institution, but we wanted to bring the university much more to life. Yeah, that actually worked quite well. I think the color scheme worked nice on the different outtakes together with the layout. Here you just see a quick draft of how this idea was, you know, with the opening. You have like, this is like invitation cards. You have the closed logo on the backside and the open logo for messaging on the inside. Just as simple idea as that. And yeah, this all go beyond, like, you know, with the social media and then together with different content, like, you know, text and layout and whatever. And we also designed an own font for them, Linz, which basically incorporates some of this humanism, technology, and spatial spheres. So these are just like a few of these principles, and these were the toolbox that we basically put this identity to life with. And yeah, here just a few more outtakes. Just a set of poster where we have the opening and, you know, the like the slogan in between. Here's just like a stage, kind of like step by step how, you know, like depending on the content, the flow of the layout could work. And here just, you know, lanyards, student cards, and the car and whatever. So whenever we had the possibility, the logo is somehow the star, but the logo basically presents, opens up the space for the content. Yeah, this is like it was a simple concept in the end, but as I said, it took three principles to really go that. So really sometimes it's not just one idea, it's more ideas. Yeah, that was just an example for this. It also like worked quite nicely, I think, on social media. And yeah, on all kinds of like merch and tote bags and whatever. I also brought like just a quick showreel to sum this up. By the way, I'm not checking Instagram all the time. It's a remote control. The second project we were working on was a project we did for CERN in Switzerland, which is this European nuclear physicist institution. I guess most of you know it. And it's for a big, actually the biggest research project they do right now, which is the Future Circular Collider. You maybe are familiar with the LHC, the Large Hadron Collider. It's a big like underground machine. It's really several kilometers long, and it accelerates light particles in two different like areas. And on one point, they collide, and actually the way how they collide and the way what they produce is basically gathering information on the existence of dark matter, about the Higgs boson particle, for instance, and also like how probably the Big Bang occurred and how basically our world existed and the whole universe. So it's like a huge scientific operation with like a very, very complex, how can I say, a very, very, very complex structure. There are like a lot of different elements, a lot of things to consider. There are scientists, researchers, there are hundreds of people there basically exploring this Big Bang in a way. And there are people in penguin pullovers that basically come up with this idea. And you know, you often think of work that you do, that's not rocket science, right? That's just, it's easy. But that fucking is rocket science. This is fucking rocket science. This is so complex that not even like he knows about it, but like several people don't know what he's talking about, right? So, and how you want to communicate like a thing that is so so massive, you know, in an understandable manner, to, you know, to stakeholders, to people who are interested in the process or whatever, like. It's we had no chance like really going too elaborate on this. We had to go back to like a core, and of course we start with sketching. We start with doing, you know, like it has to be a circle because it's a circular collider, and you start on drawing circles and you start off dreaming of circles and whatever, but in the end you end up like losing all your like drawings and you basically take a piece of wire and just form like a circle and see, and basically you see, okay, it's open. It's like even a circle can be open, you know? And this is the way how the circular motion of the particle basically can nicely be described, because it goes in circles, there's like another one coming from the other side, so the circle motion, the simple circle motion, becomes interesting in a way that you actually never saw. And the concept we had is, okay, if FCC is able to kind of like make the world like make this kind of like this vision that they have visible in a way, you know, like this vision of the particle accelerating, maybe we can like with the identity for this, and that was our brief, we had to design an identity for this machine, for this science approach. Maybe we can like change the way how to look at a simple circle. So that was the idea for the logo. It became like this open circle in different kind of like stages in a way. And that was basically part of the identity. Pardon me. I think now. Okay, sorry. Not working, but there's another video, no worries. So we have these different kind of like stages of a circle opening up, gathering together, creating like this different shapes. And we just started using the shapes, right? We use it on posters, we use it for social media. We just used the shape together with weird photography, because it was a very weird and mind-blowing concept. So you need weird photography to kind of like get this weird aspect in it as well. And that basically was the identity, and it worked quite well, and it's still like ongoing, and it's still like can say in a way like it's an ongoing project. It needs like probably decades to be like realized and really get some information out of it. But the identity is there, and I think it's strong enough to really also carry through the different years. So yeah, here just like a few outtakes. You know, it works on the workwear of the work is there. Of course, everybody loves icons, so we had to define an icon system as well, which worked quite nicely. And this was also used for social media, for all the campaigns, for the podcast and so on. So all these weird kind of like information bits and pieces they had to get out, that really becomes like a very strong vessel for them. I'm wondering why actually this video is not working, but hopefully this video is working, and it basically sums up the whole process, I think, quite nicely. So you also see the logo in motion now, hopefully. So this was like a great project to kind of like really go deep into the realms of science in a way, to really dig into like future fields also, that are always like nice when you like work on the more commercial clients. Sometimes you always need a balance, and it's good that like our studios really like initiated to that we have like a really great balance of clients. Like we have a good balance of really commercial clients, retail clients to culture clients, whatever, architects, artists. We do exhibition design as well. We work a lot for museums. So yeah, just to balance that. But one thing that we work in is the last project that I would like to show. And it was a project actually that we did completely in Vienna. So this was one of the first projects that I did at Bleed. It's for a radio channel in Norway, NRK P3, which means P3, program 3. NRK like is the state like ORF in Australia. It's a national broadcaster, and P3 is basically a youth channel, and it's hosted by all these nice people. Like they're all like gathered in this kind of like tribe like setting. It's like this everybody has their own show. There is like people doing like for instance on the right side, the people are doing a lot against racism in Norway. You know, they're really very progressively kind of like trying to really change society there. There are like TV hosts, news journalists, there are coaches, you know, there are people like really dealing also with sensitive topics like youth topics, sexuality, everything. So this is like a very, very interesting was an interesting client to approach on, because it's so diverse. There are so many different factors, and actually NRK had like a big challenge. The challenge was they were basically like they even want to focus more on social media and going more into video and screen-based content. And they also want to link the brand P3 more to the mother brand NRK, you know, like OF. And they have all these like all these weird people here, like she, and so like they really wanted to produce content, you know, and they really wanted like to create like a toolbox for them to really like be more independent and more like self-driven to put content out on themselves. And the idea that we had basically is the old NRK P3 logo. And here, the NRK is pretty hidden. It's down there, right? And we were focusing on this logo because it was so particular. It has like this interesting geometric shapes. It's not quite perfect. It's not like, you know, this streamlined geometric shapes, but they have like character. And I had the hope when you have something with character, you can build an identity out of it, yeah? So what we did, we basically took the logo of the NRK and defined a concept we call Remix. And yeah, basically we split up the logo in its different parts. We totally put it apart. And then like different kind of like toolbox. Come just in, come, sit in, sit here. Don't be shy. And then we created all these toolbox. We created an icon system, of course, because everybody loves icons. And we did a type system. We did also like a display type face for them to really like make their content even more like lively and really like work into it. So yeah, basically they also got a new logo where the NRK becomes much more present and the P3 becomes more linked to the brand. So this is actually what they were aiming for. And we did a typeface in 3 different cuts. That was the first time I did a display typeface. I'm not one of these type nerds who really is into like, you know, fumbling around curves and stuff. I need to be things bold and present and out there. And as I said, I come from illustration, the Radiohead cover, huh? So there was like, there was just something that I wanted to get this out quickly. So yeah, there was, and actually the process was pretty self-driven then. We had like the typeface that worked nicely on all the different outtakes. And we had these people. And we decided, like, as I said, like this was all these like tribe kind of thing of these people like sitting in this office and working together, and it was a very lively atmosphere there. So we said, okay, why don't we create like totems for them? Everybody gets his own like icon, kind of like a sub-ident, where they really become like, you know, like a part of the whole, but also independent. Like, yeah, there was just a way to really link them to the brand, but like making them also like totally like independent and really like self-aware of what they're doing. And here's just like a few of the outtakes of the icon system. They were all animated. The demon for the like rock topic kind of things. Of course, also the dog got one. Of course, people love icons, so we did icons, even more icons. There were much more than these, just a few things. So really, these were all like a toolbox we gave to the bloggers and the people who created content, so the people become like very independent to really work on the different outtakes. And The project was very successful. It was really like nicely sent out, and this is just something that, you know, like is like a was a learning for me, because when you send out stuff, you know, into the public, then really magical things can happen. Like really people can really like create work that's more than you did. It just becomes like a self-driven kind of thing. And that's something that really inspires me. And here I said again, like as from the example, like with the CT cover, I said, you're really able, like I feel like I'm more able to like create like a certain kind of setting and a context that make things last. Then in best case, create experiences, then in the very best case, create memories. Because as I said, the memories are experiences that last. So this is basically kind of like the conclusion that I would like to give you, like really be inspired to create your own memories, because like in the end, that's all we have. And yeah, I will just finish up after the last showreel. Just enjoy it. It's very poppy and colorful. And yeah, just thank you very much for having me. And yeah, just come by. I'm here until tomorrow and say hi. And I'm happy to see you.
Think before I talk.
Jeg snakker først, og tenker etterpå.
I am made of.
Tygemerker, det nye?
Do we have time for questions or no, we're over time? No. It's fine. You could just come after me.
Ja, ich denke auch, also vielen, vielen Dank, Marc, ein wahnsinnig spannender Vortrag. Und ich glaube, Fragen können wir dann einfach heute Abend beim Bierchen noch vielleicht beantworten. Sehr gut, okay, Daumen hoch. Wir bauen ganz kurz um, dass wir die Filme zeigen können. Das dauert vielleicht 5 Minuten, dann geht es direkt wieder weiter. Also entweder sitzen bleiben oder kurz Pipi machen, dann wieder reinkommen, dann geht's los. Wir freuen uns sehr.